So one of the primary things that we're doing on this expedition to Thailand this summer is scaring fish. And there's a real good reason why one would want to scare fish. One, it's really fun and hilarious a lot of the time, just kind of seeing them freak out and sort of what that looks like. But that's actually not that important. That's just more personally fulfilling. The second reason, which is far more important, is that the fish species that we're studying are ecologically critical in that they consume algae, they eat algae, they're herbivores. And if these algae are not consumed enough, they can grow out of control and they can kill coral, which are the foundation species that make the ecosystem for all the other critters. You know, corals themselves are structures that provide all sorts of niche space and little living places for all sorts of different life. Fish, invertebrates, and obviously they're incredibly charismatic. Corals themselves are charismatic and they draw a lot of eco-tourism revenue. So there's a lot of reasons why these fish are critical from a conservation and sort of economic perspective. So we are scaring these fish because we want to understand how these fish tick, what makes them make the decisions that they make. Because at the end of the day, what we actually are trying to do is be able to predict fish individual decisions using simple mathematical equations that we're able to derive from our field experiments. And then using these simple mathematical equations, we can then scale up to not just understand how individual fish behave, but how, if a bunch of fish behave in predictable ways, what does that mean for the population of fish? And what does that mean for the ecological function that that population provides, which in this case is controlling algae, that can be really dangerous. And what does it mean long-term? What does it mean for the fish population long-term, their function long-term, and the species that depend on that function long-term, namely coral? So there's a lot of amazing insights that we can get if we can understand what makes these fish tick. And one of the most important aspects of their behavior that we need to understand better is predator avoidance, which is extremely important in the wild because wild animals, unlike most humans, don't really have the luxury of not being hunted all the time. So these fish are hunted. They're hunted by sharks, they're hunted by grouper, they're often hunted by humans, all sorts of predators. And so we really want to understand, how do these fish behave on a moment-to-moment basis, given that they're dealing with this landscape of risk? And can those behaviors be predictable based on, say, how they interact with other fish? We know that lots of wildlife behave very differently when they have others from their species around them, when they got their crew with them, essentially. There can be a lot more boldness in many cases when a wild animal is surrounded by other wild animals that sort of share needs, they share the same predators, that sort of thing. And so we are systematically scaring reef fish that are in a whole range of social contexts, from solo individuals all alone to large groups, in some cases 300 to 400 fish. And everything in between that. And these groups are comprised of single species in some cases, and usually not when they're very big, but sometimes small single species groups, and then mixed species groups. And so we want to know, how do these guys respond to threats? Do those responses depend on who is around them? And as an added layer, might that relationship between sort of social context and fear responses, might that also depend on the landscape? Because we know that these fish, they can get shelter from corals. And coral, the amount of coral in a reef is highly variable over the landscape. And you can, as case in point, here's a reef right here. And you can see where you see big boulders, those are big corals. And then among those boulders, there are often little flat spots. And those are much more exposed to predators. They can be much riskier for fish to go in and fill their bellies with algae. So anyway, we're systematically scaring these fish, and we're trying to understand what dictates those decisions to either flee from our simulated threats or stay and eat. And we do that using this, which we actually invented on the fly here. This is just a piece of aluminum angle iron. And it's great because it's nice and rigid, and it allows us to fasten a bunch of different cameras to it. So these are just mounts. I don't have the cameras on it right now, but here's a mount, here's a mount, here's a mount, here's a mount. So we have four ultra high definition video cameras that we can mount to this guy. They're all pointed down, so we'd be holding it like this, all cameras pointing down. I'll show you video clips of this too in this video. And so we can see a lot of area. We can see the fish from above. We can see their behaviors. The nice thing is, because we have multiple cameras, and the reason we have multiple cameras is that by having multiple perspectives, we can actually see these fish in three dimensions when we reconstruct the movements of these fish with multiple perspectives. So that's kind of awesome. We can track them in 3D with this what we call the fear stick. And one of the reasons it's called the fear stick is not just because it's a stick, but because we have a little lead sinker weight with a fishing line attached to it. And we drop this at fish, again, across social contexts, different species of fish in different areas of the reef, many times. So each of these drops is a trial. We drop it at the fish. The fish perceives what we call a looming stimulus. So it's seeing an object coming at it from above, and it's an object getting much, much bigger. So it's a rapidly approaching object. And our previous work shows that these fish can be quite responsive to that, as can all sorts of critters. It makes total sense. Like, if something's about to hit you, you tend to freak out, right? But your willingness to freak out and leave might depend a lot on how sort of confident you are. Maybe you have a bunch of friends around you and you're less likely to freak out. So that's sort of what we're looking at with these fish. And so we do this over and over and over and over and over again, hopefully with sufficient replication that we can really iron out very specific patterns of how these fish influence one another. And we can comb out some really interesting things about how maybe certain species of these fish actually play very specific roles, and how the size of the group of these fish can play a really important role in how each individual perceives the risk landscape that they're experiencing. So that's our research in a nutshell. There's a lot more to it than just that, but that is it in a nutshell. We'll let you know how it goes.